PhD in astronomy. I did research in quasars and galaxies at Caltech. But one reason I'm here to address the science faith issues is I'm also a pastor at a church that's sandwiched between the Jet Propulsion Laboratory, Caltech, Fuller Seminary, and the headquarters of the Skeptic Society. So I head up a weekly skeptics class where we invite these skeptics to come and dialogue with us. And this kind of topic we're talking about tonight, it kind of fits in with what we do. I'm the founder of Reasons to Believe, as an organization that focuses on developing new scientific evidences for the existence of God and the inerrancy and inspiration of the words of the Bible. If you want a summary of the three talks that I'm giving, we have this card outside at our book table. And basically, this is a quick summary of what we believe to be the most powerful scientific evidences for the existence of the God of the Bible and the trustworthiness of the Bible. And there's also a little thing you can fill out there that gives contact information. And if you fill it out, we'll give you a free copy of this DVD, Cosmic Fingerprints. He said, what is this DVD? It's where I tell the story of how my studies in astronomy and what I shared with the audience this afternoon. I'm kind of a nerd. I started studying astronomy seriously when I was 7 years of age. Knew that would be my future career. And it was my astronomy that brought me to faith in Jesus Christ 8 years before I met a Christian. Now, that's because I grew up in Canada. In Canada, Christians are hard to find. Here in Colorado, you can't avoid not bumping into them. But it literally took me 8 years to have any kind of relationship with a Christian. It was my astronomy that persuaded me. But the talk I'm giving tonight focuses on the origin of life. And you say, what's the astronomer doing talking about the origin of life? Well, you've probably heard about the discipline astrobiology. And astronomers have basically taken over the origin of life question from a biologist. And as I give my talk, I think you'll understand why this has happened. But from a biblical perspective, the Bible actually teaches three separate origins of life. I mean, when you talk about origin of life on a campus like this, it's the origin of a first life form. But it actually, if you look at Genesis 1, it speaks about the origin of the physical life, that's creation day one. Life is purely physical. And creation day five, it speaks about life that's not only physical, but also soulish. And that these creatures are endowed with mind, will, and emotions. And then we'll be speaking about tomorrow at 12:30, the origin of the one and only species, that's body, soul, and spirit. But tonight the talk is going to be in the origin of the first life. Tomorrow I'll talk about the origin of the third life form, and actually I have about a minute where I'll talk about the second origin of life and how it contrasts with the origin of human life, but that's tomorrow. So this is the origin of the very first life form on planet Earth. And the question I'll be addressing is, did life evolve from a primordial soup? And the naturalistic story for this goes all the way back to Charles Darwin. In fact, it really goes back to Immanuel Kant. Immanuel Kant is really the one that launched the theory of Darwinian evolution, but it was Darwin that made it really publicly popular. But in Darwin's book, he talked about how life arose from a small, warm pond. And when I was at the University of Toronto, I took a course from Carl Sagan, and in that course he talked about the origin of life from his perspective, and he says Darwin got it wrong. It's not a small warm pond, it's a really big warm pond. And he talked about how the primordial Earth was a water world, no continents, just this enormous ocean, and how life arose from this vast sea of concentrated prebiotics that percolated for nearly a billion years. And he developed in that course that he taught us the naturalistic model for the origin of life. And by naturalistic, I mean non-theistic model. Namely, that life arose late after an enormous passage of time. He said we need at least a billion years. It arose under benign conditions, in other words, optimal chemical and physical conditions, in a huge prebiotic soup that was filled with concentrated prebiotics, where there was abundant homochirals. Carl Sagan recognized that you can't get an origin of life unless all the amino acids are lined up left-handed and all the ribose sugars are lined up right-handed. So he says, yeah, we believe that's the way it is. And out comes one single species, a very simple species, what is referred to as LUCA, the last universal common ancestor. So it's basically a single bacterial species that's simpler than the simplest bacterium we have on the face of the earth today. Now, I want to contrast this with the Bible story for the origin of life. And a lot of people are surprised about this. Does the Bible really address the origin of life? Well, it really does. In the sense that you see in Genesis 1:2, now the earth was formless and empty. Darkness was over the surface of the deep, and the Spirit of God was hovering over the waters. But I put the Hebrew verb in there, rahah. It's used only one other time in the Bible, in the book of Deuteronomy, where it speaks about a female eagle that's hovering over her newly hatched eggs. And basically it's making the concept of this mother eagle bringing to life the eggs that she had just hatched. And so a number of Hebrew scholars say that's what's going on in Genesis 1:2. It's referring to the origin of the first life. And so in creation day one, let there be light. Light passes through the atmosphere. And this is when photosynthesis can begin. And it's making the point that as early as physically possible on planet Earth, we're going to have the origin of life. And so you get the following biblical predictions about the origin of life. It's not going to be late. It's going to be very early as the physical conditions would permit life to exist. It's going to be under hostile conditions. Hey, where do you get that? It says the world was formless and void. And in the original Hebrew, those have negative connotations, basically making the point the origin of life occurred under conditions on planet Earth when the Earth was hostile to the existence of life. And if you go to Psalm 104, it speaks about that, the first life on planet Earth, not being simple, but being complex, diverse, and abundant. Now, when I say complex, I don't mean animals. The Bible tells us animals don't show up till creation day 5. So these would be complex, unicellular life forms. But it's basically making the prediction, contrasted with the atheistic prediction, it won't be a single life form. It's going to be an ecology of these unicellular life forms. That it's going to be a miraculous event, it'll be instantaneous, and it's going to be marine life, because it's going to take place at a time when the entire surface of the earth is covered with water. The land life will come later. Now, what I want to review for you is what the scientific evidence has revealed over the past few years. And part of this comes from my colleague, Fuzz Rana. He's our staff biochemist. And Fuzz and I have been attending Origin of Life research conferences. These conferences are held every 3 years, and it includes the world's foremost Origin of Life researchers. And they allowed us to come in and participate in those meetings. And a lot of what you're going to be hearing tonight is from our experience attending those Origin of Life research conferences. Well, one of the things we noticed, even as far back as 1999, Origin of Life conference, was that we now know the origin of life happened in a very narrow window of time, in a geologic instant of time. How do we know that? We know that from something called the late heavy bombardment. And so what you see here is a graph of the bombardment history of the Earth. And what you notice there, you would expect bombardment to be intense when the solar system is really young, because that's when you get all these planetesimals floating around the solar system. But as the solar system ages, that would subside. But then there's this spike that peaks around about 3.875 billion years ago. And that peak is caused by the movement of Jupiter and Saturn. So when the solar system is young, you've got Jupiter and Saturn migrating inward towards the sun, then they change and migrate outward. But it's such that Saturn moves faster than Jupiter. And there's a moment in the history of the solar system, when the solar system is roughly 700 million years old, when Saturn makes one orbit for every two orbits of Jupiter. That's called a 1-2 mean motion resonance. And what it did, it destabilized the asteroid and comet belts of our solar system. and caused a massive rush of these comets and asteroids moving into the inner solar system. And you can see the evidence of that by looking at the moon tonight. Almost all those craters you see in the moon were caused by that late heavy bombardment, over 90% of the craters. And you look at Mercury, you can see that also it's heavily cratered, Mars. In fact, what's interesting, if you look at Mars, it's got a thin atmosphere. Mercury has a thin argon atmosphere, and the moon has a very thin argon atmosphere. But in all three bodies, you can see very slight weathering of the craters. And by looking at that weathering, you can date when this late heavy bombardment occurred, and it's slightly less than 3.9 billion years ago, which is the same date we get for this 1-2 mean motion resonance. So we got really good evidence. And by the way, if you look at the moon, planet Earth took 30 times the damage that the moon took. And so basically planet Earth, 3.875 billion years ago, was turned into a molten state. And that would have been clearly impossible for any origin of life scenario. But what's really interesting is that we have isotope signatures telling us that the origin of life on planet Earth took place, according to one research study, 3.825 billion years ago. Another one says 3.830 billion years ago. And we're looking at about 40 to 50 million years for the planet to cool enough from the late heavy bombardment that you could have liquid water on the surface of the Earth. And so with a late heavy bombardment, basically a hot molten state, you're looking at 40, 50 million years for it to cool off. But you can do the math. Take 3.875, 3.87, subtract off 0.04, 0.05, what number do you get? That's the same date we get for the origin of life by looking at the isotope signatures for life. Here's one research paper you can go to. The oldest rocks date to 3.825 plus or minus 0.006 billion years, and they show three separate isotope signatures, which we'll speak about in a minute, telling us that not only did life exist as far back as then, it existed in considerable abundance and diversity. And so that's where we get the conclusion the origin of life happened in an infinitesimal window of time. And so this is a profound challenge. You've got life originating in a whisper of time. Niles Eldredge, an atheistic evolutionary biologist, wrote this in his book. One of the most arresting facts that I've learned is that is in the very oldest rocks to stand a chance of showing signs of life, we find those signs. The very oldest rocks in the face of the Earth show the signs that life exists that far back. Not only do we realize the origin of life happened without time, it happened without a suit. Now, I think you can get the point. If you have no time and you have no suit, you have no naturalistic model possible, even conceivably possible, for the origin of life. How do we know there was no suit? Well, it's because of the missing prebiotics. Okay. If you've got carbonaceous molecules, you can tell whether they came from an organic source or an inorganic source by looking at the ratio, for example, of carbon-12 compared to carbon-13. All of you here have more carbon-12 in your body compared to carbon-13 than non-organic carbon. That's the property of all life. And by the way, different life forms have different ratios of carbon-12 to carbon-13. That's also true of nitrogen. Life prefers nitrogen-14 to nitrogen-15, and it prefers sulfur-32 to sulfur-34. And so chemists have looked for the signatures of these carbonaceous molecules of a non-organic source, and they can't find any. Everywhere they look on the Earth, all these carbonaceous molecules are postbiotic, none of them are prebiotic. Earth never had any prebiotics. They're all the signatures of postbiotics. And so the fact that we see zero evidence that Earth ever had the prebiotics tells us that the origin of life happened without the benefit of the building block molecules and without the benefit of any time. Now, no time, no soup. We also understand now why the primordial Earth did not have any prebiotic building block molecules. It's something called the oxygen ultraviolet paradox. In fact, it was at that 1999 Origin of Life conference that a Romanian physicist, and this is what's interesting about these Origin of Life meetings, they used to be attended only by biologists and biochemists. Now it involves all the disciplines. And it was a Romanian physicist who got up and gave a talk where he said, we all know that oxygen is catastrophic to any kind of possible prebiotic chemistry. I mean, those of you who have taken high school biology or biology here at the university have probably heard of the early Miller experiment, where they put some chemicals inside a flask, put a spark in it, and they got a little bit of glycine out of it, the simplest of the amino acids. They were scrupulous in making sure there wasn't the tiniest amount of oxygen in the flask. Induce even a very tiny amount of oxygen, nothing happens. But it was, as Romanian physicists said, you also have a problem if there is no oxygen. If you have no oxygen in the Earth's oceans or in the Earth's atmosphere, there's nothing to stop the hard ultraviolet radiation coming in from the sun to the surface of the Earth and in the ocean. And that also is catastrophic to Origin of Life prebiotic chemistry. So his point is, if you got oxygen, it stops the process. If you don't have oxygen, it also stops the process. That's the oxygen ultraviolet paradox. And the other thing is that there is no source of homochiral molecules. There was a biochemist by the name, by the name of Bonner, who spent 25 years searching here on planet Earth for some place where we actually had a supply where the amino acids were all left-handed in their configuration. If you're not familiar with this term, there are 20 biological amino acids. 19 of them come in two different configurations. One with a hydrogen atom on the left side, one with a hydrogen atom on the right-hand side. And in order for these amino acids to be linked together to make proteins, they all have to be left-handed. Alternately, they can all be right-handed, but they can't be left and right. They all have to be of one hand. And likewise, if you want to put the nucleic bases together to make DNA and RNA, the sugars that link these DNA, these nucleic bases, all have to be right-handed. And nowhere do we find a source of amino acids where they're all left-handed or they're all right-handed, which caused astronomers to begin looking for homochiral molecules in outer space. Because what we learned in cyclotron physics experiments is that if you have circularly polarized ultraviolet radiation, it actually gives you a slight amount of left versus right. Only a few percent, but they said, hey, maybe that would happen if we get, say, next to a neutron star or a black hole, which is the one place where we find in the universe an intense source of circularly polarized ultraviolet light. But I can tell you as an astronomer, I can't think of a worse place to try to make these amino acids than right next to a black hole or a neutron star. You're lucky even to have particles, let alone atoms and the molecules in that vicinity. But the truth is, even there, we don't find a source of homochiral molecules. They don't exist anywhere on Earth or the universe. And the other challenge is that we now know the first life was not just a single simple bacterium. That's much simpler than the simplest bacterium we have in the face of the Earth. We actually see evidence for photosynthetic life. Photosynthetic life that's oxic and anoxic. We see evidence for a great variety of methanogens. In fact, we actually see at least 8 different species of unicellular life forms that date back to 3.825 billion years. And actually, that's critical, because if you don't have this diversity of unicellular life forms in considerable abundance, you can't launch and sustain the plate tectonics that are going to be critical for making the continents so you can have advanced life. It's actually crucial that life originate exactly 3.825 billion years ago, give or take a little bit, in order to get the plate tectonics launched at the only time that's going to be possible in order to bring advanced life here on planet Earth. Well, back at the 1999 and the 2002 Origin of Life Research conferences, I noticed in both conferences, planet Earth was ruled out in the first morning of the conference. and they spent the rest of the conference saying, now we know the origin of life can't happen on planet Earth, that is, from a non-theistic perspective. It must have happened somewhere else in outer space and got delivered to planet Earth. And so the second day of the conference was focused on Mars. And the theory was life originated on Mars, and then a meteor transferred that life from Mars to planet Earth. That's how life got here on planet Earth. But as they began to research Mars, and by the way, it took until the 2002 Origin of Life conference before they recognized Mars is not a candidate. Number one, they recognized Mars too would have suffered from this late heavy bombardment. So you got the problem that just like on Earth, you don't have any time to make the origin of life happen. And unlike Earth, you've got a carbonate crisis. We do have good evidence that when you go back to about 4 billion years ago, Mars was warm and wet. But the problem is those warm, wet conditions would cause the water to chemically react with the carbon dioxide to make carbonates. And because you don't have the aggressive plate tectonics on Mars like you do on Earth, those carbonates do not get reconverted back to water and carbon dioxide. They remain as carbonates. So on the face of Mars, the carbonates you see there have been in that form literally for the past 4 billion years. And that explains why Mars went from warm and wet to permanently dry and cold. The water and the carbon dioxide in the atmosphere, which would have warmed the planet, was transferred into carbonates, leaving Mars with a thin atmosphere, which brought about the permanent cold, dry conditions. And the other thing we notice is that the craters on Mars are not heavily eroded. If the water and the carbon dioxide had remained for any significant period of time, we would expect a lot more erosion of the craters on Mars, and we don't see that. That's another piece of evidence that the carbonate reaction must have been very rapid. And so it only been a very tiny window of time when Mars would have been warm and wet. And just like with planet Earth, you've got the same oxygen ultraviolet paradox. If you got oxygen, it's going to stop the prebiotic chemistry. If you don't have oxygen, it's going to stop the prebiotic chemistry. And there is no source of homochiral molecules. And at both these conferences, they said, okay, let's try making it happen on maybe the moons of Jupiter and the moons of Saturn. And that got ruled out in fairly short order. And we have a book outside which explains how that got ruled out. I won't go into that in detail. But the third day of the conference was said it happened in interstellar space. That's actually a good option because the richest source of carbonaceous molecules that we see anywhere in the universe are in interstellar molecular clouds. In fact, as of last count, we have found 125 different species of carbonaceous molecules in these interstellar clouds. And so the conference really focused saying that's where the origin of life happened, and then it got transported to the Earth. However, as it began to research interstellar cloud life, and this is where the astronomers really got involved, they said, yes, we found these 125 molecules, carbon-based molecules, but we can't find any ammonia. And ammonia is critical to make all the prebiotic reactions work. No ammonia, you're really stuck. The other thing is, there's no sugars. By the way, the only place you see 5 and 6 carbon sugars are in life or the remains of life. We don't see them anywhere in the non-organic realm of the universe or the Earth. They simply don't exist. What's the most complex we have found? They have found 3 carbon glycoaldehydes, but they can't get up to the 4, the 5, or the 6. And life needs the 5 and 6 carbon sugars. They don't exist. And what happened at these conferences, say, yeah, but wait a minute. There's this paper published in the Astrophysical Journal where they found one of the 4 nucleobases in one of these interstellar clouds. And there's a lot of excitement about that. And they said, yeah, and we've also found glycine, the simplest of the 20 amino acids. And by the way, it is simple. There's only 10 atoms that make up glycine. However, it was 2009 where 2 papers were published in the Astrophysical Journal where they said our previous publication, we made a mistake. We misidentified the spectral lines. We really didn't discover glycine. We really didn't discover a nucleobase. So the scientific literature today says in these interstellar clouds, we have no nucleobases and we have no amino acids. Now, by the way, I expect that to change. Given the existence of these 125 carbonaceous molecules, it's inevitable that one day we'll find at least a couple of the amino acids and maybe one or two of the nucleobases. But astronomers have made measurements where we now know it's going to be parts per billion or less. And if it's parts per billion or less, we know that it's going to be impossible to harvest those amino acids and nucleobases for the origin of life. And you can find articles on our reasons.org website. For example, they have found six of the bioactive amino acids in meteorites. What we now have discovered is that when a meteor goes through the atmosphere of the Earth and crashes into a hard place on the surface of the Earth, the crash actually chemically generates six of the 20 bioactive amino acids. It's the six simplest ones. The 14 most complex ones we've not found anywhere. There's no natural reaction that, for example, makes tryptophan, the most complex of the amino acids. We see that nowhere. We'll only see the simple ones. So there's 14 critical amino acids that are totally missing in all sources. And likewise, in the interstellar clouds, we see racemic mixtures of the amino acids only. It's always a random mixture of left-handed and right-handed chemicals that we see there. Well, at this conference, I noticed that the Origin of Life researchers didn't give up. They said, well, we don't know how it happened, but it must have happened because we actually have life here on Earth. And kind of what we've noticed, I think we're the only two Christians at this conference of 300 plus researchers. And what I heard them saying during the breaks is, well, we all know for sure there is no God. That's our starting point. And because life is here, it must have happened somehow. We just don't know how yet. And so they spent the next day of the conference saying, let's assume it happened, even though it looks like it's impossible. Let's assume it happened. How does it get from these interstellar clouds to planet Earth? Because these interstellar clouds are not nearby. The nearest significant one is 1,500 light years away. So that's a considerable distance. One light year is 6 trillion miles. So how do we get it across interstellar space? And they said, well, there's comets outside of our solar system. Maybe a comet escaped from a distant interstellar cloud or maybe another planetary system, and then it crashes into the Earth. But a number of researchers got up and said, well, as it goes through interstellar space, it's going to be exposed to X-ray and ultraviolet radiation. And that X-ray and ultraviolet radiation will break down the building block molecules. So, for example, the lifespans of some of these amino acids under interstellar space conditions is hours and days. Well, that's a problem because the transport time is in the millions of years. To get them from one of these interstellar clouds or from another planetary system to the surface of the Earth, you're looking at millions of years, typically 10 million plus years to get here. And the breakdown time from ultraviolet and X-ray radiation measures in hours and days. And then when it goes through the atmosphere, it's going to destroy, because when it comes through the atmosphere, it's going to be heated up to a minimum of 500 degrees centigrade, and that temperature is enough to pull apart the molecules. Which led to this last day of the conference where they said, okay, there's no way we can get a dust particle harboring maybe some bacterium or harboring the building blocks of life and bring it to the Earth because it's going to get exposed while it's radiation. It's going to take too much time. But what if we were to bury a bacterium or a set of building block molecules inside a rock? Well, one astronomer got up and said, it will have to be a rock with no cracks and no air bubbles in it, because otherwise the radiation is going to get through. He also calculated that we're going to need a rock a minimum of 2 meters in diameter. A 2 meter diameter rock with no cracks and no bubbles in it, and you've got a bacterium in the dead center, it will survive going through interstellar space for a few million years. And they said, well, that's how life got here on planet Earth. This big rock fell upon the Earth, broke up when it hit the Earth, and out popped this bacterium. That's the origin of life. Never mind how the bacterium got inside that rock or how it would form. But it was Jay Malosh, an astronomer, who gave a paper where he said, well, Let's do a thought experiment. Let's presume that our Milky Way galaxy has 100 billion planets in it, where those 100 billion planets are stocked with life as abundant in bacterium as planet Earth is. So, unreasonable, but let's just assume that. 100 billion planets with as much bacteria as the Earth, and these 100 billion planets are being bombarded with big rocks, and it's such that it causes rocks on these 100 billion planets to leave the gravity of those planets and be distributed throughout our galaxy. That was the scenario. Then he calculated the probability that you would get one rock hitting the surface of the Earth. And he said, forget about 2 meters. I'm going to calculate the probability of getting the rock the size of a human fist. And I'm not going to worry about the cracks or the bubbles. I'm just going to go for a rock, whatever it is. And what he calculated is that planet Earth would receive one such interstellar rock every 10 to the 16 years. Now, that's a million times older than the age of the universe. The universe is only 10 to the 10 years old. And so we only get one rock every million times the age of the present Earth. And so basically, they concluded a rock is not going to make it happen. Well, at the very end of the conference, the scientists came. By the way, what I loved about the conference, they had a microphone there where in between the delivering of papers, anybody could come up and ask a question. And so there's a lot of good discussion going on at that point and also over meals and during breaks. But he got up to the microphone and said, what we've done at this conference, we've ruled out planet Earth as a candidate for the origin of life. We've ruled out Mars. We've ruled out the moons of Jupiter. We've ruled out the moons of Saturn. We've ruled out other planetary systems. We've ruled out panspermia, dust somehow transporting the ingredients of life to planet Earth. And we've ruled out rocks. He says the only thing left is directed panspermia. Now that was a term invented by Francis Crick and Leslie Orgel back in the early 1980s. And if you don't know about this, and by the way, Leslie Orgel gave the first lecture at the 2002 Origin of Life Research Conference. He's famous for what's called the RNA first model. And by the way, in terms of the chemistry, there's basically three models. One that says membranes first, because you got to be able to enclose these molecules. One says we're going to have the proteins first. Another molecule says we're going to have the DNA and the RNA first. And what's entertaining for Fuzz Rana and me, we listen to proponents of these three models destroy the other two models. And it was Leslie Orgel, who is a proponent of the RNA first model, who got up in the first lecture and he said, I hope there are no creationists here in the audience for what I'm going to say next. It would take a miracle for an RNA molecule to show up on the surface of the Earth. But I'm also here to tell you, it would take a miracle for a membrane to show up, or a miracle for these proteins to show up on the origin of the Earth, which is what motivated this scientist to say directed panspermia. What is directed panspermia? It's this idea that intelligent beings on another planet built spaceships and traveled from their planet, came to our planet, and planted life here on planet Earth 3.825 billion years ago. And the scientists went on to say, you know, this is a wonderful theory because we can also explain the Cambrian explosion of animal life, we can explain the Avalon explosion of animal life, and we can even explain the origin of human beings. The aliens kept coming back over the past 3.8 billion years. That explains all the mass speciation events we see in the fossil record. Now, some of you are laughing, but this is actually very seriously considered. In fact, Leslie Orgel himself wrote a famous book with Francis Crick, a Nobel laureate, where back in 1981, they seriously proposed this model. However, it raises a question. Where did these intelligent aliens come from? And it raises a profound question because we now have the physics to understand you can't get intelligent beings any earlier in the history of the universe than 13.8 billion years. In fact, one reason why we see this long history of life on planet Earth, life must happen as early as physically possible in the history of the universe, and it must happen immediately. The reason why we see such a tiny time window for the origin of life, if life doesn't originate as early as physically as possible, and as quickly as physically possible, there won't be enough time to have human beings. It takes a minimum of 3.8 billion years of abundant life on planet Earth in order to make possible the existence of human beings with a capability of launching technology. I got a book coming out on that next year, why that must be the case. But given that it takes that kind of time, you can't have intelligent life existing 3.8 billion years ago. Maybe bacteria, but not intelligent life. And so they couldn't have brought these creatures here to planet Earth 3.8 billion years ago. So it's the origin of the aliens, but there's another problem. How could they get here? And I've written a book back in 2002. It's titled Lights in the Sky and Little Green Men. I don't think we have it on the table out here, but you can get it from us. And basically what I write in that book is why we can be confident that aliens have never visited planet Earth, simply because of the laws of physics. And maybe you're fans of Star Trek, where they go warp 9, and a lot of physicists will ridicule that and say, at best you can go warp 1. Well, actually, at best, you can only go about warp 0.01. If you try to go faster than 1% the velocity of light, your spaceship will be destroyed by the collisions with particles that exist in our galaxy. So you've got to slow down your spaceship. And if you slow down your spaceship, you're looking at very long passage times from the nearest conceivable planetary system that could house this life. And by the way, I'm friends with a lot of people that are searching for extraterrestrial intelligent life. I went to grad school with a lot of the leaders of the movement, and they've already ruled out anything within 200 light years of planet Earth. We now know that there's no society as advanced as we were back in 1945 anywhere within 200 light years of us. Matter of fact, I've argued that if there's intelligent life, they would have been here to shut us up, because we've been polluting our galaxy with the Beverly Hillbillies and a lot of other TV shows that would have been obnoxious to these aliens. So, but we don't see anything like that coming from stars anywhere within 200 light years. Matter of fact, as I engage my friends who are part of the search for extra intelligent life, I say, you don't have to listen for signals. All you need to do is see if you can find a star that would have the capability of having a planet orbit about it that could sustain advanced life. And the truth is, we've yet to find a star anywhere in our Milky Way galaxy that's sufficiently like our sun that it could be a candidate to have a planet orbiting it, sustaining advanced life. Maybe bacterial life, but not advanced life. And for 50 years, we've been looking for a solar twin. Lots of stars have twins of one another, but our sun has no twin. So that actually rules out not just the nearest 200 light years, but we're ruling out tens of thousands of light years as a place where advanced life could exist. And the problem with that is you're now looking at a travel time from these planets to our planet that exceeds the maximum conceivable time an intelligent civilization can maintain high enough technology. So what is that limit? I won't go into the details, but maximum is 2,000 years. You can't maintain a technology as advanced as we have for more than 2,000 years. And so you have to get from that planet to our planet in less time, and the laws of physics don't allow that. By the way, the community of atheist scientists at the Santa Fe Institute have drawn the same conclusion we have at Reasons to Believe, that directed panspermia simply won't work. Now, what has happened at the Santa Fe Institute is that they now realize the Darwinian model for evolution doesn't work. It can't explain the origin of life or the history of life on planet Earth. They're very skilled mathematicians. And I actually heard Stuart Kaufman give a lecture at Caltech. He's the director of the Santa Fe Institute. In 30 minutes, he mathematically demolished the Darwinian model. But what he came up with in the next 30 minutes was his explanation of the origin of life, that there's a hidden law of physics, which he calls a fourth law of thermodynamics. And Stuart Kaufman's fourth law is the opposite of the second law. He's basically saying in this vast universe, there are tiny regions where you get very big departures from thermodynamic equilibrium, departures that are so big, it explains the origin of life. Now, two responses I have to that. He is right. Thermodynamics does not say that everything has to be in thermodynamic equilibrium. Matter of fact, none of you in this room are in perfect thermodynamic equilibrium. You will be when you're dead, but as long as you're alive, you're not. So we're all departing from thermodynamic equilibrium. But the principle of thermodynamics is the more you depart from thermodynamic equilibrium, the faster you have to return. And the problem with Stuart Kaufman's explanation of the origin of life is the snapback time. The snapback time for something as complex as getting life out of non-life is much less than a trillionth of a second. And the problem is life has been here for 3.8 billion years, so it's hung around too long. The other problem I would have as an astronomer, we know there can't be a fourth law of thermodynamics, because one of the conditions for life existing in the universe is that the universe on large scales must be homogeneous and uniform. And that homogeneity and uniformity requirement for the existence of life rules out the possibility of its fourth law of thermodynamics. So what's left? Hidden law of physics? Well, when we were at this Origin of Life research conference, where this physicist got up and said, we've ruled out Earth, we've ruled out all the bodies in the solar system, we've ruled out panspermia, interstellar clouds, and directed panspermia with rocks. And then all we got left is these intelligent beings. We said, you know, we think they're partly right. It is an alien that brought life here to planet Earth, but not an alien that's subject to the laws of physics of the space-time dimensions of the universe. It's the one that actually created the space-time dimensions of the universe and the laws of physics and the matter and energy that makes up the universe. Again, you can get the recording of the talk I gave at lunchtime today, where I talked about why it is that even atheist physicists and astronomers now realize there must be an entity beyond space and time that created our universe of matter, energy, space, and time. I call that entity God. They call it the great entity beyond space and time. I think the definition is the same. So that's what we think is responsible for the origin of life. It's the spirit of God hovering over the surface of the waters that created life 3.825 billion years ago at the earliest possible time, and actually sustained his creation activity to make sure the Earth was packed with as much life as possible, as diverse as possible, and as long as possible, so that we human beings at the very end of the window of time for the existence of life here on planet Earth could actually thrive for a few thousand years. By the way, that's the other part of the story. Earth, relatively soon, will become sterile. It'll become sterile because the sun is continuing to get brighter and brighter. It won't be long before the sun has too high of a density in its nuclear furnace to permit the existence of life here on planet Earth. But by creating us last of all, I'll be talking about this tomorrow, by creating us human beings last of all, we're the beneficiaries of 3.8 billion years of biodeposits being built up in the crust of the Earth. And so we have the benefit of oil, natural gas. This is the School of Mines. Are you aware that most of the minerals that we mine were concentrated by sulfate-reducing bacteria? And they have to work for 3 billion years to get ores up to a sufficient concentration in insoluble form so we can mine them and launch metallurgy. If it wasn't for those 3 billion years of sulfate-reducing bacterial activity, we would have never gotten out of the Stone Age. I don't know about you, but when our family celebrates Thanksgiving, we thank God for the sulfate-reducing bacteria and made it possible for an institution like the School of Mines to exist. But you can read about this in our book, Origins of Life. And by the way, what's exciting about this book is after we published it, we got a phone call from one of the world's leading Origin of Life researchers, David Deamer. And we met him at the conference. He's an atheist. But he said, I want to review your book, but I want to get your permission to review your book, and I'm going to be critical. We said, please, the more critical you are, the more we're going to be able to benefit. We're planning to do a second edition. We can only benefit from your criticism. And he wound up reviewing our book and publishing it in Origins of Life and the Biosphere, so you can see it in a peer-reviewed journal. But I'll tell you basically what he said about our book. He says, it's the most scientifically comprehensive book on the origin of life. the only book he had seen that actually covers all the scientific disciplines. He says it's the most up-to-date, it's also the most scientifically accurate. I like everything about the book except the Jesus Christ part. And then we got a phone call from him about a month later where he said, for the sake of my children, I hope you guys are right and I'm wrong. But he's still, but I mean, we got a good review of the book. And if you want to read about the second origin of life, I brought this book out a couple years ago because it's the book of Job, the oldest book in the Bible, that deals most extensively with the origin, the second origin of life, the origin of life forms that are not just physical, but also endowed with mind, will, and emotions, a reference to the birds and the mammals. But I'll be talking a little bit about that tomorrow, and then mostly about the origin of human beings. And by the way, we have a book called Who is Adam out there that talks about the origin of human life. We're going to take a brief announcement from the sponsors of this event, then we're going to go to Q&A, and during the Q&A, I'll take any question you've got. Doesn't have to be in tonight's talk or this morning, this afternoon's talk. I'll take any question, but I do have one rule for the Q&A time. One question per person per turn, and no fair giving me a six-part question, okay? If you got a six-part question, I'm going to ask you to take six separate turns.
And we'll start off with a question from the audience here, over here on this side.
Got to congratulate you. That is probably the most impressive and extensive strawman argument I've ever seen. You're presenting to a group of people who really don't have the experience, which almost nobody could in all the specific studies you've cited, but what it seems like is you've cherry-picked all the studies to give yourself a really great story. And so I can't comment on a lot of them, but I'll just comment on one. You just said it takes 3 billion years to be able to accumulate the amount of metals that we mine in current ore deposits. That's a really difficult thing to say in this building, given that most of the metals that we mine take copper. Most of that metal comes from what's called a porphyry deposit.
I understand that.
In less than a million years, in fact, the one I studied did. Additionally, we have VMS style deposits, we have epithermal style deposits, we have many, many types of deposits, and none of them actually take 3 billion years to form at all, given that we find these deposits in rocks of ages of less than 5 million years. So that's just one study and one claim that you made that is completely false.
Well,
I can't speak to the rest
okay,
of them,
let me stop you there.
Show that you've made a lot of claims to an audience that really isn't able to dispute anything you said, which is contrary to scientific practice in which you have lively debate.
Understand, I'm not claiming that all the metals took that long of period of time. I'm not claiming all the metals came through organic mechanisms. But I am saying that some are critical. And here's the larger story. Here's the larger story, is that the primordial Earth had a lot of metals in soluble form, metals that we refer to as vital poisons. There's 22 elements in your human body that if they're there in soluble form in too high of an abundance, they'll kill you. If they're there in too low of abundance, they'll also kill you. And the reference to the sulfate-reducing bacteria is it is those bacteria that actually transform the state of these metals into a form that will not be deadly for advanced life. That's what takes the long period of time. But yeah, I fully concede your points. There's lots of other ways we can get metals without appealing to biology and without appealing to a long period of time. The anthropic principle?
Anthropomorphic principle. Essentially, it doesn't matter how unlikely it is. It doesn't matter how much time it took. The fact that we're here and we see evidence for the processes having happened means it happened. You don't need to invoke God at all.
Well, that question came up at noon today, and I made the point that this was actually addressed by the British philosopher Richard Swinburne more than 20 years ago. And the way this anthropomorphic principle operates is to say, we know we're here. And therefore, we wouldn't be here to observe all of this amazing sequence of events unless that sequence of events was exactly the way it was. So this isn't the hand of God. This is the way it has to be just for us to be here to observe it. But it was Richard Swinburne who exposed the philosophical fallacy in that line of argument. And he did it through coming up with an analogy. The analogy he came up with was the firing squad. Okay, you're condemned to die by firing squad, and you're standing there blindfolded, and you got 12 sharpshooters with high-powered rifles with telescopic sights standing 20 meters away, and they're told to put a bullet through your heart. You survive the event, and you take the blindfold off and say, well, of course, I wouldn't be here unless they all missed. And Richard Swinburne's point is, it wouldn't be rational for them to miss unless they intended for you to survive. Either that or somebody put blanks in their gun. Somebody purposed that they would survive the event. Likewise, he says, when you look at all these amazing fine-tuned characteristics for the universe, our galaxy, our solar system, Earth, Moon, etc., the only rational conclusion is that somebody purposed that we human beings would actually be here 13.8 billion years after the cosmic creation event.
Would you concede the point that it's possible for one man with a very high-powered rifle and a scope to miss the target?
Well,
is that possible? One person can miss a target.
If he intended that person to die, the probability that he would miss would be extremely low.
But is there any probability that that person would miss? I mean, people miss in wartime all the time, and they intend for the person they're trying to shoot to die.
Well, let me put this question to you. Okay, have you ever heard, there's a fallacy in that too, in the sense that lots of people have been condemned to die by firing squad. How many of them survived by accidental misses? I mean, you're 20 meters away, you got a high-powered rifle, you got a telescopic sight, it doesn't take too much of an aim to get a bullet into that individual's heart.
And many people have survived hangings, firing squads, the electric chair.
All right, we'll come back to you, but let's take another one.
We'll move on to a question written here. Actually, two individuals wrote a similar question, so I'll name them both. The first is, why does life have influence on plate tectonics? And then the second one that is similar is said, please explain why microbes are necessary to launch plate tectonics. I thought radioactive decay in the Earth's core fueled plate tectonics.
Yeah, very good question, and actually the answer is partly implied in the question, in the sense that there are unicellular life forms that work to precipitate uranium, and there's forces that actually bring those uranium precipitates into the subduction zones of the Earth, and that provides enough heat energy to actually make the subduction work. It's a study done on black shales. And so, you know, these black shales are made that way by these unicellular life forms, but you actually see a high concentration of uranium precipitates as a result of those life forms.
Another question from the audience. Let's go right here.
What about non-carbon-based life?
Non-carbon-based life ruled out about 35 years ago. In the sense, when you look at the periodic table, 35 years ago, they're saying maybe we can make it work with boron, maybe we can make it work with silicon, maybe we can work with arsenic. But what they discovered with those possible options in the periodic table, in no case do you get the bonding stability and the bonding complexity that you get with carbon. So if you want life, physical life, it's got to be carbon-based, wherever it exists in the universe. It's not going to work with any of the other elements.
Let's go ahead and do another one from the audience back here.
In light of the fact that the Bible was written by human beings.
Pardon me?
In light of the fact that the Bible was written by human beings who are fallible, how can you be 100% certain that the Bible is infallible and can be trusted?
Okay, good question. The Bible's written by 39 different human authors. These human authors are fallible people, they make mistakes. How can we be confident that what they wrote in the Bible is actually infallible? Well, the heart of the Christian faith is that these 39 Bible authors were inspired by God's Spirit, and because they're inspired by God's Spirit, what they wrote was rendered free of error and contradiction. And you say, what is the evidence for that? Well, you'll actually see a statement in one of the books of the Bible, 1 Peter, which makes a point that here these prophets of old were being inspired to write, and they didn't understand everything they were writing. It had to be content that what they were being inspired to write was for a future generation. Now, people don't typically write that way if it's coming from their own mind. Why would you write down something that would be a total mystery to you? But here's an objective way you can put it to the test. And by the way, the ancient Israelites were trained to use this test. It was Moses who said, many prophets will come after me. Many false prophets will come after me. Here's how you know whether it's a prophet of God or a false prophet. If it's a prophet of God, that prophet will make statements about the future, future science, as well as future historical events. And some of those statements will be short range and some will be long range. If the short range predictions don't come true, you're looking at a false prophet. And by the way, Moses left out a standard. It's got to be 100% perfect. One mistake, rule it out. And that's what you notice about the people who wrote the Bible, is that they frequently make statements about what will happen in the future. And often you'll see prophets, for example, making short-range predictions. This is going to happen 2 years from now, and this is going to happen hundreds of years from now. And so Isaiah, for example, talks about two virgins who will give birth to a son. And one was going to be 2 years hence, one was going to be, you know, another 700 years hence. The fact that his first prediction came true, exactly as he stated, gave people confidence that the second prediction likewise would come true. And from the 21st century perspective, we know that both the short-range predictions of Isaiah came true, as well as the long-range predictions, including predictions he made about the modern rebirth of the nation of Israel. So some of these are predictions that have literally been fulfilled in our lifetime, at least my lifetime, maybe not yours. But and by the way, that's also true not just of historical events, but of scientific events. And so that's how I became a Christian. I looked at the Quran, I looked at the Hindu Vedas, the Buddhist commentaries, the Mormon scriptures, compared it with the Bible, and I realized all of them outside of the Bible had provable misstatements and errors and contradictions. Over 18 months, I tried to find one in the Bible, and when I couldn't, I realized this isn't just something inspired by human beings, it's inspired by the one that created the universe.
A written question from a student, and I hope I'm reading this correctly. Why does advanced life only form around stars similar to our own? And shouldn't the Goldilocks zone simply change?
Okay, good question. Why do we need a star almost exactly like our star, the sun? Well, stars are like human beings. They're unstable when they're young, they're unstable when they're old, they're maximally stable when they're middle age. And the way it is with stars is that they have the necessary luminosity stability for a very brief period of time when they're almost exactly middle age. Now, our sun is capable of fusing hydrogen into helium for about 9 billion years. And right now, we're halfway through that burning cycle. And about 50,000 years ago, it entered a period of extreme luminosity stability, which is only going to last for about another 50,000 years. And climate stability is crucial in order to have advanced civilization. And by the way, we're looking at thousands of years, not even 100,000 years, because we've got overlapping at an ice age cycle where you have fairly extreme climate instability, except for the warm interglacial in which we're in right now. The other thing is that when stars are young or old, they're variable and they emit a lot of ultraviolet radiation and a lot of flares. Now, of all the stars that exist, stars that have the minimum flaring activity have exactly the mass of the sun. So you can rule out stars more massive than the sun, and you can rule out stars less massive than the sun. You can rule out stars that are older than younger. The other thing is that our sun is exceptional in its lithium abundance. And this is where we've had difficulty. We've not been able to find a star of the right age, of the right mass, with the right lithium abundance, so that we can have this extraordinary period of luminosity stability that's optimal for human life. And so that's why I've challenged my colleagues, why bother listening for intelligent signals from a hypothetical planet when you don't even have a stellar candidate? There was a second part to that question.
Yes. here we go. Shouldn't the Goldilocks zone simply change? That was the second part.
Okay, it's probably a reference to what's called the habitable zone. And, you know, we astronomers now have a catalog of 1,850 planets that we've discovered outside of our solar system. By the way, when we first started discovering these planets, the prediction was they'd be just like the planets in our solar system. So far, not a single one is like any of the planets in our solar system. And actually, it's led us to recognize every planet in our solar system plays a critical role in making advanced life possible here on planet Earth. So again, when Thanksgiving Day comes around, you might want to thank God for Neptune, Mars, Venus, and the rest of them. You can forget about Pluto, it got demoted. Pluto is actually 6 times smaller than our moon. It really doesn't qualify as a planet. But what we've been looking at with these planets is trying to see how many of them are called Goldilocks planets. Now, a Goldilocks planet is defined as a planet that conceivably could have liquid water on its surface. And if you adjust the atmosphere in some hypothetical way, you can get a fairly broad liquid water habitable zone. And if you're willing to mess with the atmosphere, you can get a habitable zone that would actually include Venus and Mars as habitable planets. Just put a really thick atmosphere on Mars, a really thin atmosphere on a Venus, and you can make it work. But here's the problem. The more massive the planet, the thicker the atmosphere that will form. The farther away it is from the star, the thicker the atmosphere will form. And Venus and Mars have the right kind of atmosphere. Mars is only 1/9 the mass of the Earth, so it's got a nice thin atmosphere like physics would predict. Venus is about 80% the mass of the Earth, so it's got a nice thick atmosphere. We now know that Earth, when it first formed, had an atmosphere that was at least 100 times thicker than it is today. It's the moon-forming event that allowed us to have a big rocky planet with a thin atmosphere and a thin layer of water. But we started off with a whole lot more water and a whole lot more atmosphere. But for advanced life, you need a thin atmosphere and a thin layer of water. But today we now know there's 8 habitable zones. You've got the liquid water habitable zone, but you also have to be in what's called the just right ultraviolet habitable zone. You have to be in the right astrosphere habitable zone, a zone where you've got the right amount of solar wind coming up in the star to keep in check the cosmic radiation, but not to be so intense as to wipe out life on the planet. Now, what's interesting is you look at these 8 different known habitable zones, the expectation is they won't overlap. In fact, the only planet we know of where they all overlap is planet Earth. All the other planets we look at, there's no overlap. So, for example, the ultraviolet habitable zone sits out here. The water habitable zone sits out here. If you want light, they both have to line up like this. By the way, there's an article on our website where we talk about these 8 habitable zones. That's the 8 we know of so far. What I notice is every year we seem to pick up another habitable zone that must be brought into the equation.
Another question from the floor up here in front.
Do you believe that we'll be able to reach interstellar travel before our sun burns out, or before we die out?
Well, I'm not a big fan of Star Wars or Star Trek because of my background in physics. This question came up this afternoon. In fact, I think I brought it up tonight, is that you can only go 1% the velocity of light maximum. And so that's not going to get you to another planetary system. They're just simply too far away. You're going to go extinct before you get there. And then you got the problem, by the way, if you really want to make it there, you better send a large population. The smaller the population, the faster your civilization on the spaceships will go extinct. So we better take good care of planet Earth because there really is nowhere else to go. People have thought about transforming Mars. It can be done. For the cost of $100 quadrillion, we can transform the surface of Mars so it's actually livable for about a 60 to 70 year period. After that, you've got to spend another $100 quadrillion. I think it's cheaper to try to manage our planet. In fact, it's a whole lot cheaper to build an artificial planet. If we really mess up planet Earth, our best option is to build an artificial planet and maybe put 10,000 people on it.
Do you think possible?
Oh, definitely. I think we could actually build something. I think in Star Wars, they had this little thing called the Death Star. You could build something like that, and you could, you know, realistically house 10,000 individuals on it and keep them alive for a few thousand years. And it's a whole lot less than trying to transform Mars. A whole lot less money.
All right, another written question. I'm going to try to read this correctly. I have previously heard that some bacteria and single-celled organisms are tough enough to survive UV radiation. I was wondering if this was true, and if it is true, would Darwinism be able to explain the evolution of life on Earth?
Right. Well, this is an interesting part of the origin of life debate that I didn't deal with tonight. And this is the whole idea of what's called extremophile life, is that maybe the conditions aren't quite so constraining, because after all, we found bacteria that can survive fairly harsh radiation. We've got bacteria that can survive very high salt conditions or high acid or base conditions. But what's interesting about these extreme forms of life is how much of their chemical machinery is focused on repairing damage from these extreme conditions. And so we're actually looking at a far more complex challenge for the origin of extremophiles than the origin of what we call mesophilic life, life that exists under benign conditions. And there's a paper published in the journal Astrobiology a few years ago with the title, Extremophiles Are Irrelevant to the Origin of Life. It's one thing to talk about the origin of a mesophilic life form. It's orders of magnitude more challenging to talk about the origin of an extreme life form. But its appeal to extremophiles has caused some astronomers to say, maybe these habitable zones are much broader than they really are. But if you're talking the origin of life, no, they really are much narrower than we think they are.
Another question from the floor.
You mentioned about 2,000-year limit to technological society. Can you say more about that?
Yeah, you'll actually see this in the sociological literature, where it makes the point that when a civilization reaches a certain level of technology and wealth, two things happen. The birth rate drops and the deleterious mutation rate goes up. And it's something we've already observed. As the wealth of a nation goes up, the reproductive capacity of the population goes down. And some of the more extreme examples of that would be cities like Tokyo, Hong Kong, and I think the worst one is Singapore. And in Singapore, they've actually passed a law where if a woman will give birth to a child, they basically shower her with money. Because what's happened in Singapore is the birth rate is down to about one half child per adult. And that's not going to be good for the long-term survivability of the human population. But what is, I think, surprising is that when it drops to a level as low as we see in Singapore, it doesn't seem like you can reverse it. Although some papers have been published, if you can drop the wealth level down and the technology level down, you can bring the birth rate back up. So that could work. And the other thing about high technology is that it forces men and women to delay giving birth. I mean, look at this campus right here. I mean, you've got all kinds of men and women putting off marriage and giving birth to children until they can get the education they need to survive in a high-tech environment. And hey, even when you get the education, you're still not ready. You need to build your career to a point where you can actually afford to have a family. And so what you're seeing around the world is that the date for the first child is going up in the population. And it's particularly catastrophic for the men. The longer men put off having the birth of the first child, the more deleterious mutations they pass off to the next generation. Now, the only country in the world where they've actually tried to measure the deleterious mutation rate is here in the United States. And this is not the most extreme example. I would say Japan or like Singapore would be more extreme examples where you've got people with wealth and a lot of technology. But here in America, it measures 3 deleterious mutations per person per generation. An evolutionary biologist will tell you it's guaranteed extinction when you got 1 deleterious mutation per person per generation. We're three times above that. And so it's that kind of research which is saying a reasonable estimate for how long you can sustain high technology with significant wealth is probably less than 1,000 years, but conservatively, a limit would be 2,000 years. Now, the solution is abandon your wealth and abandon your technology. So I propose that to my sons, saying, you know, in order to save the human race, would you be willing to let go of your wealth and your technology? I said, no, we'd rather the human species go extinct. So, and they're not the only ones giving that kind of answer. So that's why you see those conservative figures. And by the way, they're not disputed in the SETI literature, the literature in the search for extraterrestrial intelligent life. They agree with that assessment.
Another written question in regards to your quote from Genesis about the Spirit of God hovering over the waters. If the Spirit of God created life and is also within us, are we as human beings able to create life or influence our universe?
Well, you'll see a book out there called Creating Life in the Lab. It's written by my colleague, our biochemist, Fuzz Rana. And what Fuzz is pointing out is we know enough about the origin of life that we realize there's no physical or chemical barrier from us human beings being able to make life from scratch. There's only technological barriers. Now, I'm saying that statement with a grain of salt. We can't say we understand all the chemical pathways that are critical to the origin of life. But so far, what we have been able to understand, we don't see a technical barrier. And you actually have, like Craig Venter's lab, for example, taking bacteria, re-engineering it to make a different kind of bacteria. They think they can make a lot of oil that way, for example, or come up with cures for cancer by doing that. So we can certainly re-engineer life. And it wouldn't shock us if, say, 100 years from now, we get the technology to literally make life from scratch. But the reason why Fuzz wrote that book, he says, look at what's going on here. It can't happen unless you've got a billionaire like Craig Venter putting his money behind it, where he hires hundreds of the world's most brilliant biochemists and gives them the latest technology to try to make these simple steps along the pathway for making life. And so he wrote the book basically by saying it needs to be somebody better funded than Craig Venter, with more technology than his biochemists, and more intellect and education than his biochemists to create life on planet Earth 3.8 billion years ago.
Another question from the audience. In the far back.
Can you speak up? Well, it's interesting you mentioned Moore's Law, because it's actually addressed in the latest issue of Nature. They got several articles that featured their Moore's Law, basically making the point that we're reaching the limits of what Moore's Law can bring about. If you haven't heard about that, by the way, it's this idea that every 18 months, we double the capability of our computer technology. And hey, we've all benefited from that, which means, by the way, there's a downside too. It means you've got to replace your computer every 18 months because you get one that's twice as fast and twice as capable. But what they're pointing out in the latest issue of Nature, we're now reaching the limits of the laws of physics. Basically, we've been able to achieve this exponential advance in computer capability by making chips smaller and smaller and smaller. But there reaches a point where you got one atom thickness. And we're getting very close to those limits. One way you may be able to sustain Moore's Law is to try to simulate the brain. And so basically use multi-processing techniques to try to gain more capability. In other words, forget about the speed. Let's just see if we can marshal multiple computers working together. That's kind of how the brain works. So we may be able to sustain it, but even there, eventually you reach a limit. So, for example, friends of mine that are neurobiologists make the point that when you look at the human brain, it really is at the maximum size. So I mean, if you're a fan of science fiction, you've probably seen these creatures with these enormous brains. Well, what they're not taking into account is when you've got a brain that big, it cooks itself to death. 35% of our blood flow supports our brain. And if you had a bigger brain, you'd literally raise the temperature to a point where it can't function effectively any longer. So in that sense, in terms of other intelligent physical beings, you're probably looking at the most intelligent physical beings right here in this room. You're not going to get these aliens with IQs of orders of magnitude greater than us, because they're going to be under the same limitations of the laws of physics. Can you speak up? I'm having a hard time hearing you. Do I think we can stop our inevitable extinction? Yes. The way you stop it is to lower our population, lower our wealth per capita, and lower our technology. The question is, can you sell that to the electorate?
I have a written question here from a student. Could you describe what a deleterious mutation is and presumably perhaps an example?
Sure. A deleterious mutation is simply a mutation that's harmful for the individual. In some cases, it's catastrophic and kills the individual. Sometimes it just makes life miserable for the individual. So a good example would be, say, Down syndrome. What do they call the diabetes you get as a child? I forget whether it's type 1 or type 2. That's another example. But with wealth and technology, you're able to actually keep people alive that possess these deleterious mutations long enough that they can reproduce. So you wind up getting an increasing load of deleterious mutations in the population. And then the fact that we have people giving birth to children later in life increases the deleterious mutation rate. By the way, there are beneficial mutations which actually make things better for the individual. The ratio at best of deleterious to beneficial is 10,000 to 1. More typical is 1,000,000 to 1 or 10 million to 1. And so you've got a thermodynamic issue with the mutations. There's a huge disproportion of deleterious compared to beneficial, though a caveat with that is the vast majority of mutations are what we call neutral. They don't harm you, but they don't help you either. So that's the vast majority. But if you just look at beneficial and deleterious, the deleterious far outnumber the beneficial.
Another question from the floor. We're on this side.
Just one extra question concerning technology. You said, as you can see on the front range here, we have lots of fossils of dinosaurs. And we've been here roughly 2 million years. They were here 100 times longer, but apparently never developed technology. Why do you think that is? Opposable thumb, brain size, or do you have another take on that?
Well,
what purpose is it?
Okay, the question is, why didn't we have Jurassic Park-type dinosaurs that got to be intelligent enough to be, a significant threat? And you kind of answered the question. Their brains weren't that big. They were structured differently. They had to, a lot of the, especially the bigger ones, had a problem sustaining their body mass. What's interesting about the dinosaur era, it's that period when we had vast, shallow seas. And so they could take advantage of that shallow water to support their heavy body mass. And likewise, when you see Jurassic Park, you've got, by the way, it's mostly Cretaceous dinosaurs they show you, not the Jurassic ones. But they always have T-Rex charging out at you at 40 miles an hour. There's no way a reptile that big would move that fast. When you move that fast, the danger of injury is so high that it would be that those kind of capabilities would be weeded out of the population. It was moving at a much slower rate. So the idea that you can't run away from it in a four-wheel drive Jeep, that's not realistic. One of the problems I have watching those kinds of movies, as a scientist, I count how many times per minute they're violating the laws of physics. And when it gets to be more than 4 per minute, I kind of lose interest in the movie.
All right, are you going to watch the newest sequel? I guess that's the next question.
Well, typically I have to watch these movies because I get questions on them. Please tell us where they violate the laws of physics. So I'll probably watch it so I can at least be equipped to deal with that.
Another question from the field. Yes.
So I think the biggest thing is like creationism is kind of discounted as quacks because of the amount of crime, you know, especially described in Genesis. And I'm curious, you know, we've obviously been talking about vast amounts of time comparatively to the Bible. Where do those two line up or don't line up?
Well, one of the books on the table outside is our latest book. It's called A Matter of Days, which basically gets in the question, how long are these creation days in Genesis 1? Now, I first started reading the Bible when I was 17, and I started on page 1, and what I realized is this word day must have at least three different literal definitions, because on day 1, it talks about days and nights. On day 4, it talks about seasons, days, and years, as 24 hours compared to 12 hours, and then the text ends with using the word day to refer to the entire creation week. So it's obviously longer than a 24-hour period. Now that I know the Hebrew, I realize there's four distinct literal definitions for the word yom that's translated day. Part of the daylight hours, all the daylight hours, a 24-hour period, or a long but finite period of time. And notice this is an English language controversy in the Christian community. English is the largest vocabulary language that has ever been developed by human beings. And in the English language, we have over a dozen words for a long period of time. In biblical Hebrew, the only word you got for a long period of time is the word yom that's translated day. So Moses had no other way to describe six consecutive long time periods except to use the word that's translated as day. But at age 17, I quickly concluded it must be long periods of time for two reasons. On the sixth day, we have God creating both a human male and a human female. But in Genesis 2, God creates Adam first, outside the garden. He places him in the garden where he watches the trees grow. He tends the garden long enough to realize there must be more to life than gardening. And then God says, I want you to introduce you to the second origin of life. These are the creatures, the animals endowed with mind, will, and emotions. And the book of Job tells us that God designed each of these species to serve and please us human beings, each in a different way. And God basically commanded Adam, I want you to relate to each of these species and give them a name appropriate to how I designed them to serve and please you. Now that would take time. And then we have the text saying, after Adam had named all these animals, and by the way, there was twice as many birds and mammals back then as there are today. The text says that God looked down on Adam and realized he was alone. It takes time for a man to feel lonely, a little bit longer than it takes a woman to feel like she's lonely. But it takes a man some time. And then what does God do? He puts Adam to sleep, performs surgery on him, it introduces him to Eve. And what's interesting about the word that comes out of Adam's mouth in the original Hebrew, it's the word hapa'am, used more than 20 times in the Old Testament, consistently translated at long last. So I concluded at age 17, at least a year must have transpired between God creating Adam and God creating Eve, which means the sixth day can't be as short as 24 hours. But what really persuaded me is I noticed there is an evening and a morning for the first 6 days. I didn't know what the Hebrew words meant for evening and morning, but I said at a minimum, they must mean that each day is a start point and an end point. I looked at the seventh day, there's no evening and morning. I said, oh, that's the day when God rests from his work of physical creation activity. And I noticed three other texts in the Bible, Psalm 95, John 5, and Hebrews 4, all tell us that presently we are in God's seventh day, which means the seventh day likewise must be a long period of time. Now, I became serious about studying astronomy when I was 7 years of age. When I was 9 years of age, my parents were really worried that I was spending too much time studying astronomy and physics. So they went out and took a little money they had and bought me some books in evolutionary biology. I read those books and told my parents the numbers don't add up. We have all the speciation evidence before humanity and very little after. When I read Genesis 1, I said, here's the answer to the fossil record enigma. We see it before humanity because those are the 6 days when God creates. We see very little of it after humanity because that's when God stops his work of creation activity to focus on spiritual aspects of our life, namely the removal of evil and suffering once and for all. So I've always been an old earth creationist, but as an astronomer, I'm a young universe creationist. Why? Because I grew up at a time when my fellow astronomers were convinced the universe was quadrillions of years old. The reason is they wanted to save the Darwinian paradigm, and they realized if we only have billions of years, we can't save Darwin's hypothesis for the origin and history of life. We need a minimum of a quadrillion years. But it's Big Bang cosmology that convinced everybody it's only 14 billion years. So I can truthfully tell you, I'm a young universe creationist. I don't believe in quadrillions of years. I believe it's only billions of years. But yeah, the book is out there, a matter of days. And by the way, you can go to our website. You'll see a number of debates I've had with the leaders of young earth creationist organizations. And by the way, we give you the debates unabridged and unaltered. You get to see it exactly as it happened.
I think we had a question back here.
Yeah, about space travel, wouldn't there be a possibility of bending space-time around your spaceship so that you're traveling faster than the speed of light, but you're not breaking the law?
Very good question, and that was actually tackled by a friend of mine, Jerry Cleaver. He's the chairman of the physics department at Baylor University. I knew him when he was at Caltech. And so you can go on our website and you'll be able to listen to a podcast where we interviewed Jerry Cleaver, because he published a paper where he said, if we can bend the space-time fabric of the universe sufficiently, we can make our spaceship go faster than the velocity of light. But he said, of course, there's some interesting caveats to that. If we have a spaceship that's big enough to house just one person without a food supply, the energy we need to sufficiently bend the space-time fabric to make the ship go faster than the velocity of light, we'd have to consume the mass of Jupiter and convert it to pure energy every single second. So, realistically, it can't be done. But his whole point is, mathematically, there is a way to make it happen. Physically, it's impossible. Do I believe the creation story supports the Big Bang theory? You should have come to my noon hour talk. Because what I said at noon hour, that of all the holy books and religions of the world, the Bible says the most about the origin and structure of the universe. And I reviewed for the audience the four things about the universe that the Bible, in terms of cosmology, repeatedly addresses. Those four are that the universe is traceable back to a beginning of matter, energy, space, and time. Secondly, that the universe continuously expands from that space-time beginning, expands under laws of physics that don't change, or one of those laws is a pervasive law of decay. Romans 8 speaks about this law of decay that applies to the entire universe. Likewise, you see similar statements in Ecclesiastes. And then made the point that if you had a freshman physics course, then you know from thermodynamics, any system that expands gets colder and colder as it continues to expand. And therefore, the Bible actually is predicting that the universe will get colder and colder in a predictable way. And if you actually know the age of the universe, you can actually come up with a biblically predicted cooling curve of the universe. And what's interesting, as I showed the audience, measurements we astronomers have made at the past temperature of the universe, our 13 measurements perfectly fit that curve. In fact, in some cases, the error bar is smaller than the thickness of the line that you can get from that prediction. And that actually had a big factor when I was a teenager reading the Bible. The fact that I could see that it predicted all the fundamental elements of Big Bang cosmology thousands of years before any of our astronomers even had a hint that the universe had any of those characteristics, persuaded me this must be inspired by the one that actually created the universe. For example, no other book of science, philosophy, or theology even hints at a continuously expanding universe outside of the Bible until the 20th century. For thousands of years, the Bible stood alone as the only text making that claim. Likewise, it stood alone on a space-time beginning for the universe. For example, in Hinduism and Buddhism, it says space and time are eternal. The Bible says space and time don't exist until God creates the universe. So that had a big factor in my coming to faith in Jesus Christ.
One last question to end the evening. Everyone's scared to do the last question.
Yes.
We'll take two. Don't worry. We'll do these last two.
Yeah, pardon me?
The Bible says, I will bless those that bless Israel.
Correct.
Is that speaking of a particular phase of the nation of Israel? And is it speaking to literal Israel or spiritual Israel as well?
Okay. The reference she's saying is there's several passages in the Bible that basically makes the point, whoever blesses the Jews, I will bless. Whoever blesses Israel, I will bless. There's also passages that make the point, whoever blesses followers of Jesus Christ will be blessed. And so it applies not just to Jews, it also applies to Christians. And I would argue there is substantial historical evidence to back up those claims. In fact, a number of preachers and churches have made the point that the United States of America has received blessings from God from the fact that we were the ones that played a significant role in launching the new nation of Israel in 1948. Truman, in particular, took a major step into making it happen. And likewise, our continued support, I think, factors into the blessings our nation has received. There's also a counter to that. Whoever curses Israel will receive consequences for doing that. And I have a tape set, it's not out on our table, where I talk about those nations that have went to war against Israel have all suffered significant consequences, and those that have helped Israel in its wars have benefited from that assistance. And by the way, if you read the book of Ezekiel, it makes the point that when God forms a nation for a second time, that he would fight for them against their adversaries like he did during the Old Testament. But he says, when I do that, you Jews will claim we did it. You will not give me credit. But he says the Gentiles will give me credit. And so I'm going to do this, not for your benefit, but for the benefit of the Gentile nations, because they'll recognize my handiwork in blessing you, even if you don't. And that's what's been interesting about the Arab-Israeli wars, is that an Egyptian general gave credit to God for the fact that Israel won the war, but the Israeli generals would not.
Some of your writings that say that, you know, humanity may have started in North Africa or the Middle East. I hear chatter, I hear other people saying, well, it wasn't one man, one woman, it was a population of people. It could have never been one man, one woman. So, you know, as briefly or as long as you can, just comment on that.
Well, for example, tomorrow I'm getting on an airplane to go to North Carolina, where our Reasons to Believe scholar team will be in dialogue with the BioLogos scholar team. That's an organization that takes the position that humans are the product of natural descent from a common ancestor with Neanderthals and the apes, whereas we take the position that human beings are the product of special creation by the hand of God. And we're actually going to be writing a book where we present our both views. By the way, what I appreciate about BioLogos is their willingness to engage us in a very gracious manner. I'm used to being engaged by people in a non-gracious manner. But one reason why we're doing this. We think it's important to model to the Christian community as well as to non-Christians. Here are two Christian organizations that sharply disagree with one another, but they do it in a charitable way where both sides are willing to be taught by increasing evidence. But where BioLogos is coming from, as they say, if you sample the genetics of the human population, the genetic diversity seems to be too great for the human population to be centered from one man and one woman in less than 100,000 years. Our response to that is, well, that model is based on assuming that the Darwinian paradigm of common descent is correct. And so it's a circular argument. You're beginning with a Darwinian assumption and proving a Darwinian assumption. We're also making the point that you really shouldn't be confident about a theoretical model until it's verified by experimental results. And what we have reasons to believe in doing is saying there's a real need for experimental testing on this. I know of only three tests. One's been done with sheep, one's been done with horses, and one's been done with orangutans. The most definitive one was done with the sheep and the horses. The sheep experiment, they put a female and a male sheep that were very similar in their DNA, highly ingrown in terms of their DNA, and they put them on an isolated island in the Kerguelen Archipelago, an island that had no mammals on it at all, and they let them reproduce. And they went back 10 generations later and sampled the DNA. The DNA diversity was far greater than what the theoretical model based on a Darwinian paradigm would predict. And so our point is the diversity you see in the human population is going to give an overestimate of the ancestral population. That's also been verified with Przewalski horses and with orangutans. But I would like to see the studies extended to hundreds of different species of birds and mammals. Because one of the ideas we have at Reasons to Believe is that genetic diversity propagation will be most extreme for those mammalian populations that have the longest development time. And so with a sheep, you're looking at, you know, a little more than a year to develop. Orangutans, it's a few years. Human beings is 25 years. So it'd be interesting to actually do these kinds of field studies and see if there's a correlation between the generation of excess genetic diversity and the development time. The other research that I think should be done is the nurture-nature debate. There is some research papers that point out the way a human child lives during its developmental years can actually change the DNA that's passed on to the next generation. Because so much of our DNA is on-off switches, and that actually can be impacted by the lifestyle and the behavior of someone during the developmental years. And so the problem, I would say, with the BioLogos model, it's assuming it's 100% nature. We actually have evidence that nurture, not just nature, impacts the DNA. But as an astronomer, I would say this. Why are we debating creation evolution models from the context of the most complex scientific discipline, namely human genetics? Wouldn't we be wiser to punt back to things like geophysics, chemistry, astronomy, and mathematics, where things are a lot more clear-cut and where the knowledge base is a lot more complete? But it seems like these creation evolution debates inevitably go towards the more complex end of the spectrum. By the way, it's one reason why I'm speaking on human origins last. It's the most complicated. That's one reason why I chose to become an astronomer. I like simplicity. I like things that actually obey differential equations.